وإذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون.
إذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to Quran Circle 2. I'm Arkam Rashid, your host. The selected theme in this episode is Best of Nations. So let's start off by introducing and welcoming our wonderful guest. On my right-hand side, I have Sheikh Ibrahim Zidan. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the show.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you.
You're welcome. And from the reciters, on my right-hand side, I have reciter Imad Muhyiddin. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the show.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Next to him, I have Qari Ayman Abdul Mun'im. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the show.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
So go ahead, dear viewers, grab your mushaf and open it to Surah Ali Imran. Verse number 93, and our recitation will be started off by Qari Imad. Go ahead.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Kullu at-ta'am kana hillan li bani Israel illa ma harrama Israel 'ala nafsihi إلا ما حرم إسرائيل على نفسه من قبل أن تنزل التوراة قل فأتوا بالتوراة فاتلوها إن كنتم صادقين فمن افترى على الله الكذب من بعد ذلك فأولئك هم الظالمون قل صدق الله فاتبعوا ملة إبراهيم حنيفا وما كان من المشركين إن أول بيت وضع للناس للذي ببكة مباركا وهدى للعالمين فيه آيات بينات مقام إبراهيم ومن دخله كان آمنا ولله على الناس حج البيت من استطاع إليه سبيلا ومن كفر فإن الله غني عن العالمين قل يا أهل الكتاب لم تكفرون بآيات الله والله شهيد على ما تعملون قل يا أهل الكتاب لم تصدون عن سبيل الله من آمن تبغونها عوجا وأنتم شهداء وما الله بغافل عما تعملون يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن تطيعوا فريقا من الذين أوتوا الكتاب يردوكم بعد إيمانكم كافرين وكيف تكفرون وأنتم تتلى عليكم آيات الله وفيكم رسوله ومن يعتصم بالله فقد هدي إلى صراط مستقيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون واعتصموا بحبل الله واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا وكنتم على شفا حفرة من النار فأنقذكم منها كذلك يبين الله لكم آياته لعلكم تهتدون ولتكن منكم أمة يدعون إلى الخير ويأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر وأولئك هم المفلحون ولا تكونوا كالذين تفرقوا واختلفوا من بعد ما جاءهم البينات وأولئك لهم عذاب عظيم يوم تبيض وجوه وتسود وجوه فأما الذين اسودت وجوههم أكفرتم بعد إيمانكم فذوقوا العذاب بما كنتم تكفرون وأما الذين ابيضت وجوههم ففي رحمة الله هم فيها خالدون تلك آيات الله نتلوها عليك بالحق وما الله يريد ظلما للعالمين ولله ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وإلى الله ترجع الأمور كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله ولو آمن أهل الكتاب لكان خيرا لهم منهم المؤمنون وأكثرهم الفاسقون لن يضروكم إلا أذى وإن يقاتلوكم يولوكم الأدبار ثم لا ينصرون ضربت عليهم الذلة أينما ثقفوا إلا بحبل من الله وحبل من الناس وباءوا بغضب من الله وضربت عليهم المسكنة ذلك بأنهم كانوا يكفرون بآيات الله ذلك بأنهم كانوا يكفرون بآيات يقتلون الأنبياء بغير حق ذلك بما عصوا وكانوا يعتدون.
جزاكم الله خير. Thank you very much, Qari Ahmad. Sheikh, now, since our theme for this episode is Best of Nations, I just wanted to ask you if you can tell us some of the characteristics of a Muslim nation, or what a Muslim nation should be like from the verses that we recited.
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala ashraf al-mursaleen, nabiyyina Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. First, as the context of Surah Ali Imran, the first part of it, talks about calling the people of the book, mainly the Christians, to the fold of Islam and explaining the matter to them and refuting the doubts that they might have in them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after making the matter so clear, He is stating how this ummah is different than the nations before. This is the final nation, and this nation has a message. And every messenger was sent to his people, but for this ummah, the Prophet ﷺ is the final messenger of Allah. There's no messenger to come. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it part of the responsibility of this ummah to call others to the deen of Allah and to have this benefit extended to others. Human beings, if they are benefiting to one another, they are great. But when it comes to anything in this life, whether they're benefiting others with food or wealth, this is all limited to this life. The most valuable thing is guidance. The most important thing in life is for people to be saved from the hellfire, to know the purpose of their life. So this ummah of the Prophet ﷺ has been given the best quality ever if they would act according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them, and that is to spread the deen of Allah, to give the da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to call people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. That's why it's a set of verses that talks about this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. You're the best nation ever brought to mankind. But this is not like that, absolute, without any conditions to it. No, it's conditioned. Once these conditions are met, this is the best nation ever brought to mankind. When the conditions are not met, then it decreases this khayriya or this goodness accordingly. And of course, the best of all of these generations are the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. They were the best generation ever brought to mankind, as the Prophet ﷺ said, then the tabi'in, then the tabi'i tabi'in. And those who followed them, they would be the best according to how much they followed their footsteps. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in these verses, the matter of enjoining good and forbidding evil, giving da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the criteria. Once the ummah, they leave this job and they put it behind their back and they don't have the concern to others, they don't enjoin good, they don't forbid evil, they don't call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they lose this goodness and they become punished in this life by being humiliated. And the verses that are more, of course, rulings when it comes to, even sometimes it becomes mandatory for certain individuals. Otherwise, the whole entire ummah of the Prophet ﷺ becomes sinful if the message is not being carried out to others, to call people to the tawheed and the oneness of worship of Allah.
Thank you very much. One thing that you did mention was about the concept of encouraging good. We're going to get into this later on, inshallah. But before I do that, I want to ask you about one of the verses that Qari Imad recited. It said, وَمَنْ دَخَلَهُ كَانَ آمِنًا, speaking about the area in Mecca where the Kaaba is. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mean when he says, وَمَنْ دَخَلَهُ كَانَ آمِنًا? I mean, we know throughout history that there were certain people that were killed in the Kaaba. So what does this mean, وَمَنْ دَخَلَهُ كَانَ آمِنًا?
This is, as the ulama, they say, this is to show the duty of the believers and those who are taking care of the town of Mecca and the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That this is mandatory. Whoever enters it, he has to be secured. That's why it's a major, major sin to intend, only to intend to do evil in Mecca. This is a major sin, which is not the case in any other part in the world. So the intentions, just to have the intentions to do evil and to cause harm to others in Mecca, this is a major sin. And that's why this is an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the believers, and also in general, this is what a person would have throughout the years, except maybe some exceptions here and there.
Okay, I want to move on to another verse. وَعْتَصِمُوا, but for that, if we can have, inshallah, Qari Ayman recite that ayah for us, وَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ.
واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا وكنتم على شفا حفرة من النار فأنقذكم منها كذلك يبين الله لكم آياته لعلكم تهتدون.
Thank you very much. Sheikh, now, before I get in a overall understanding from you for this verse, I just want to ask you a very specific question, which is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءَ. What does he mean by this?
Many times in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would order the believers to remember things, to remember the favors of Allah. Mm-hmm. It's basically saying, remember the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on you, that you were enemies, and then he brought your hearts together. The fact that you were enemies, and this enmity was something that would let a war be in state for 40 years or so. People fighting each other, killing each other, you know, when they were in the times of jahiliyyah, ignorance. And who's the one that brought these hearts together? فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ. He's the one that brought these hearts together, which shows that the hearts, when it's together, it's not by what human beings would do to get the hearts together. It's all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mm-hmm. So it's a great lesson for all of us that if we all wish that all the hearts of the Muslims to be together, if we spend money, if we do whatever it takes to bring the hearts together, it would never be together unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will for that to happen. And when would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will for that to happen? If people are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we fulfill the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Sahaba radiallahu anhum did, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought their hearts together, because the verse says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَقُوا. Hold fast to the rope of Allah, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, the deen of Allah, all of you, no exception. And warning not to split. And this ummah will split, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, as the Prophet said. But the difference between this ummah, these nations, and the nations before, because they also split, the nations before, there's no way for them to go back to the way it was to their prophets, because it's abrogated, it's finished, it's distorted. But for this ummah, the order is still valid, and they're ordered to stay united on the truth and not to split, because the truth is saved for us. This is what makes this ummah significant. The Quran is saved, the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is saved, the way the companions of the Prophet ﷺ and how they dealt with things is saved for us. And this is what we need to go back to and unite ourselves on this, and to be patient and not to be in disputes, my opinion versus your opinion and all of this. This is all disputes, but rather to bring the hearts together when we're holding fast to the rope of Allah and being away from these means of splitting and dispersion and so on.
Okay, now I want to go back to one of the concepts that you mentioned earlier on in the show, which was the concept of encouraging the good. But before I do that, I'll have one of the reciters, inshallah, recite it for us. I hope you guys are keeping up. This is verse number 110, so follow along. Qari Imad, if you can recite that for us.
كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله ولو آمن أهل الكتاب لكان خيرا لهم منهم المؤمنون وأكثرهم الفاسقون.
Jazakallah khair. Thank you very much, Qari Imad. Sheikh, so I want to go through this ayah little by little, because there's a couple of things that are mentioned here. So if we can start with the concept of enjoining good and discouraging bad. Let's start with this concept, inshallah.
This is what makes this ummah the best ummah ever brought to mankind, is the fact that they don't keep the benefit to themselves, they extend it to others. And this is the perfection. And one of the ulama, he mentioned this in the tafsir of the ayah, which will come inshallah ta'ala in Surah An-Nisa, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and saying, Ya ayyuha an-nabi, harrid al-mu'mina ala al-qital. Fight for the sake of Allah, you are only responsible for your action, and encourage the believers. He said that this is what makes a human being perfect. In general, that you're responsible for your action, that means make sure that you do it perfectly. That's good, but that's not enough till you encourage others to do the same, to do what is good. And that's what is so unique to this ummah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that one of the duties of this ummah, that it believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fulfill the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it perfect itself when it enjoins what is good and forbid what is evil, with the levels of doing so, of course, so that the khayr and the goodness prevails and the evil, because anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade is evil, is wicked, is impure. And that's why all these sicknesses and all these evil things that spread all over the earth, because people staying away from the orders of Allah. So for the ummah to extend this benefit to others on the individual level, on the nation level, this will bring all kinds of goodness and it make them the best ummah. And also to see the significance, it's not what people think. If you get a survey from human beings, what you consider to be the best ummah? They would say the most sophisticated technology-wise, the people they have human rights here, that, you know, whatever people they have their own understanding. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth, is stating for us how to be the best ummah is one that believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This believing in Allah, associating partners with Allah, makes an ummah, a nation, the worst ummah. Even if they look from a distance that they are doing decent things, this is only in this life, but they did not fulfill the purpose of their life. And that's not enough till they again enjoin, they advise one another. They forbid evil from one another, and this is the best ummah, not from what we say, but from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us.
And something that you mentioned was that there's different levels of encouraging good. What does that mean? Does it mean that every single person is allowed to encourage the good, or a certain person is supposed to encourage the good? How does that work?
Right. In Islam, we do not say or act unless we have the proper knowledge before we act. And that's why if a person reading the Quran like this and start acting, by taking general terms, this can be very destructive. So we have to understand how to enjoin good and forbid evil. Who's the best example in our life? The Prophet. And the Prophet made the matter clear in the Sunnah, in his speech and actions. And he made that there are levels. If you have authority over something, as the Prophet ﷺ, he said that clearly in the authentic hadith, that you have to then for enjoin the good and forbid the evil based on your authority. That means whoever has the ability to change the munkar or the evil with his hand, then he should do so. Who has the ability to change with his own hand? If you have authority. So the people of authority, they change or they give the authority to those who they have. Your household, you're the father. You have authority over your household. You don't allow evil to be in your household with goodness and decency, but you remove it with your hand. You don't say, well, I just need to be kind and say things. This is your place. Right? You have authority over your place. If you don't have authority, right, then you go to the next level, which is with speech. Whoever is not able to change with his own hand because he does not have an authority, then he changes it with his tongue by saying to the people, advising people in a nice way that this is harmful for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants good for you. And if they listen to him, mashallah, this is great. If they don't, he has no authority over them. If he's not able to do that even, right, maybe it's harmful for him to do that, the least of all of these levels, which is something that all Muslims can fit in this, and that is with his own heart. How can a person forbid evil with one's heart? By staying away from it. That's what it means. Not to be just indulged into haram and what people are doing of sins, and you say, I hate it with my heart. No, you stay away from what, when people are doing something wrong, you don't associate yourself with them while they're doing it. You stay away from them, You advise them. If you're not able to advise them, you stay away from them if you're able to do so. So it shows that it's mandatory on every Muslim. As a Muslim, you should not accept to be present when the sins and disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being committed.
Very interesting. I mean, I think it's very important for everybody to grasp what you just said right now, that each person has its own role in terms of encouraging good. I mean, somebody that's not in authority shouldn't go and try to change things with his, you know, physically, with his hands or however physically, because he's not in authority. It's just going to cause a fight, or it's going to cause more trouble and more fitan. Just the last part of this verse, and then we'll go for our short break. It says, وَلَوْ آمَنَ أَهْلُ الْكِتَابِ لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ مِنْهُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَأَكْثَرُهُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. So it says minhum al-mu'minun, meaning some of the Ahlul Kitab are believers, or what's the...
Yes, some of the people of the book are believers when they accepted the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they became believers when the message was presented to them. But again, because the Quran does not contradict itself, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it so clear in the Quran that they had disbelieved those who say that Allah is three, or those who say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Isa, the son of Mary. And even if they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and they believe that Isa alayhi salam was a messenger of Allah, if the message of the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam came to them, was presented to them, and they rejected it, that means they disbelieve in the messenger of Allah. And what's the ruling for us as Muslims? If a Muslim disbelieve in Musa alayhi salam or Isa alayhi salam, does that person becomes a Muslim, or he's outside the fold of Islam? He's a disbeliever. Disbelieving in one messenger of Allah makes a person a disbeliever. So if they disbelieve in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or refuse to follow him as the final messenger of Allah, they are not believers anymore. So minhum al-mu'minun, among them are the believers, those who followed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when the message presented to them, or at the time of the prophets. And most of them are rebellious. They disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when they disbelieved in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
All right, thank you very much, Sheikh. I hope you guys are enjoying the show so far. Keep your mushafs nearby, because we will be back soon.
الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد رضي الله عن المؤمنين إذ يبايعونك تحت الشجرة فعلم ما في قلوبهم فأنزل السكينة عليهم وأثابهم فتحا قريبا ومغانم كثيرة يأخذونها وكان الله عزيزا حكيما.
Who was Qarun? What was the Prophet Muhammad's relationship with his wife like? How did the Prophet Muhammad deal with the accusations that were directed towards his wife? How did Musa travel with Al-Khidr, and what was the relationship like, and what did they learn together? What are the important, practical, relevant meanings behind the story? We're going to be going through Quranic stories together. I'm your brother Hussam Hilal, and the purpose of this program on Huda TV, inshallah, is to learn and understand the Quran in a better way that will aid in our memorization and implementation and our understanding. I look forward to
قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون.
قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا وإذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون.
Welcome back to Quran Circle 2. Now, before we went for that short break, we were discussing the Islamic concept of encouraging the good and discouraging anything that would be classified as evil. Now, we will continue the recitation from where we left off, which is verse number 113. We will recite until verse number 132. So, reciting for us these verses is Qari Ayman Abdul Munim. Go ahead.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ليسوا سواء من أهل الكتاب أمة قائمة يتلون آيات الله آناء الليل وهم يسجدون يؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر ويأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر ويسارعون في الخيرات وأولئك من الصالحين وما يفعلوا من خير فلن يكفروه والله عليم بالمتقين إن الذين كفروا لن تغني عنهم أموالهم ولا أولادهم من الله شيئا وأولئك أصحاب النار هم فيها خالدون مثل ما ينفقون في هذه الحياة الدنيا كمثل ريح فيها صر أصابت حرث قوم كمثل ريح فيها صر أصابت حرث قوم ظلموا أنفسهم فأهلكت وما ظلمهم الله ولكن أنفسهم يظلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تتخذوا بطانة من دونكم لا يألونكم خبالا لا تتخذوا بطانة لا يألونكم خبالا ودوا ما عنتم قد بدت البغضاء من أفواههم قد بدت البغضاء من أفواههم وما تخفي صدورهم أكبر قد بينا لكم الآيات إن كنتم تعقلون ها أنتم أولئك تحبونهم ولا يحبونكم وتؤمنون بالكتاب كله وإذا لقوكم قالوا آمنا وإذا خلوا عضوا عليكم الأنامل من الغيظ يغيظ قل موتوا بغيظكم إن الله عليم بذات الصدور إن تمسسكم حسنة تسؤهم وإن تصبكم سيئة يفرحوا بها وإن تصبروا وتتقوا لا يضركم كيدهم شيئا إن الله بما يعملون محيط وإذ غدوت من أهلك تبوئ المؤمنين مقاعد للقتال والله سميع عليم إذ همت الطائفتان منكم أن تفشلا والله وليهما وعلى الله فليتوكل المؤمنون ولقد نصركم الله ببدر وأنتم أذلة فاتقوا الله لعلكم تشكرون إذ تقول للمؤمنين ألن يكفيكم أن يمدكم ربكم بثلاثة آلاف من الملائكة منزلين بلى إن تصبروا وتتقوا ويأتوكم من فورهم هذا يمددكم ربكم بخمسة آلاف من الملائكة مسومين وما جعله الله إلا بشرى لكم ولتطمئن قلوبكم به وما النصر إلا من عند الله وما النصر إلا من عند الله العزيز الحكيم ليقطع طرفا من الذين كفروا أو يكبتهم فينقلبوا خائبين ليس لك من الأمر شيء أو يتوب عليهم أو يعذبهم فإنهم ظالمون ولله ما في السماوات وما في الأرض يغفر لمن يشاء ويعذب من يشاء والله غفور رحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تأكلوا الربا واتقوا الله لعلكم تفلحون واتقوا النار التي أعدت للكافرين وأطيعوا الله والرسول لعلكم ترحمون
جزاكم الله خير. Thank you very much for that wonderful recitation. Thank you very much. Sheikh, I want to start with verse number 118. It speaks about how we should deal with non-Muslims. If you could just explain that to us, inshallah.
This is a call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the believers, how to deal with the disbelievers and with the hypocrites, as it's mentioned in the tafsir, those who would show signs of hypocrisy. Yeah. those who want harm to you, how to deal with them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forbidding the believers from taking them as close advisors, if it's correct to say. Bitana, the word bitana is mentioned. This is what you have, the lining of your jacket, which touches your skin, right? Or the piece of clothes that touches your skin. So don't make them intimate, close to you, so that they would harm you if they want to. To treat them or to deal with them with carefulness when it comes to sensitive situations or things that would harm the believers and so on. Why? Because, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they would love what caused harm to you. And hatred is shown in their mouths. How is that? With the words that they say. They say words that shows and to indicate that they hate you. They want harm to you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is advising the believers, don't take those who would show these signs as a close friend. You know, this is actually foolishness if you would do this. But rather, to take precautions, you would still treat them with justice. But those who would show enmity towards you, you have to keep the distance so that they don't harm you. And the verses goes on with this, and this is by the mercy of Allah to protect the ummah and to protect the believers. And if they don't follow the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they should not blame anyone but their own selves when harm happened to them.
Okay, and another thing that's mentioned in these verses speaks about riba. Can you just enlighten us a little bit about this?
This is an interesting part of the verses, because the verses from 121 start talking about the battle of Uhud. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminding the believers, or the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, with the battle of Badr and the lessons learned from the battle of Uhud, because it was an interesting battle. But within these verses and the context of the battle and the fighting and the lessons learned and the hypocrites and the disbelievers and so on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring this order and the call from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to the believers not to deal with riba, usually. It's such an amazing thing, which, as the ulama, they say, it shows that how these things are so much close related. This is leads to this. This, if people would disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it would lead to their own defeat. Right? Why there's defeat? Why there's humiliation? It's because of the disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If people think that if they are given strength physically and wealth and weapon and so on, they will be superior. For Muslims, it doesn't work this way. You have to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, it's a war from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it's mentioned in the end of Surah Al-Baqarah, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declare war against those who deal with riba, usury, interest, and so on. Him and his messenger subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can imagine the state of the ummah today, where riba is in almost every corner. And how we need to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is an opportunity for us to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from usury, from interest, which is haram. That is not just a normal sin, it's a major sin, it's a destructive one, as the Prophet ﷺ said, and it brings the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala onto those who deal with it.
Okay, and looking at verse number 123, Shaykh, he says, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّةٍ فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. What is he talking about here when he says wa antum adilla, right? He's made you win in Badr.
Right. This is another ayah, subhanAllah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching the believers in the context of the battle of Uhud, that Allah is reminding them that He gave you victory in the battle of Badr when you were adilla. The word adilla has two meanings. It means when you're humble or humiliated or so. It refers to whether it means, as some said, you were weak. Physically, the believers were weak. They were 300-something versus 1,000 of the disbelievers. So they were weak physically, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that gave them victory. They were not compatible whatsoever when it comes to physical strength, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them victory. Another meaning to it, that you were so much humiliated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah gave you victory when you humbled yourself to Allah. The Prophet and the night of the battle of Badr, as the narration says, that he kept on awake all night, alayhi salatu wasalam, begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help. And he would say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the meaning of which, that if this group of people are destroyed today, no one would worship you, O Allah, on earth. Meaning that they are so much outnumbered. And the Prophet ﷺ was making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a humble way. So because of this humbleness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them victory. Because if arrogance is in the heart, if people think that they can defeat their enemies because now they are good in number, good in strength, this is one of the footsteps or one of the means of defeat. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminding the believers that in the battle of Uhud, they face difficulties because of what? Because of these things that creeped into their hearts, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purifying their hearts from this.
Okay, and I want to move on to the verse right after it, but we'll have Qari Imad recite it for us. إِذْ تَقُولُ أَنْ بَلَىٰ إِنْ تَصْبِرُ. Go ahead.
إِذْ تَقُولُ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَلَنْ يَكْفِيَكُمْ أَنْ يُمِدَّكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ بِثَلَاثَةِ آلَافٍ مِّنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ مُنْزَلِينَ. بلى إن تصبروا وتتقوا ويأتوكم من فورهم هذا يمددكم ربكم بخمسة آلاف من الملائكة مسومين.
Thank you very much, Qari. So, Sheikh, he recited two verses. In the first verse, God speaks about 3,000 angels. And in the second verse, he's speaking about 5,000 angels. What is he talking about here?
This is the aid that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the believers in the battle, the battle of Badr. When they were so much, again, outnumbered by the disbelievers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that it wouldn't be sufficient for you to be given 3,000 from the angels. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increased the matter if they are patient and if they fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them this. And this is the 5,000, and this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory to the believers, to have the hearts to be content. Otherwise, everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to teach them a lesson that victory and defeat, it's all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to your actions. That's why the next verse, it says, وَمَا النَّصْرُ إِلَّا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَكِيمِ. That victory is nothing except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Aziz, the Almighty, nobody can defeat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Hakim, the most wise, he decree matters with his wisdom subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that the hearts of the believers are not attached to the disbelievers or to the physical means. They take the physical means to the best of their ability, but their hearts are fully attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that victory is in the hands of Allah for those who give the victory to the orders of Allah. In Tansurullah and Surkum, as it's mentioned in other verses in the Quran, if you give victory to Allah, meaning to the orders of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you victorious. Guidance. If you're guided, then you'll be victorious. And that's why human beings, they are in need of guidance more than victory. Because if they are guided, they will be victorious. So this was a great lesson to them. And when they kind of didn't follow this to the best of their ability in the battle of Uhud, when this just disobeying one order of the Prophet ﷺ, there was a loss in the battle of Uhud as a result of that.
Very interesting. Now, Sheikh, we're almost towards the end of our episode. What I would like to ask you, as we do usually in every episode, is that if you can give us an overview of the selections that have been recited today.
Surah Ali Imran, and the first portion of it, as we said, it was calling the people of the book, mainly the Christians, when they came to the Prophet ﷺ, and it deals with how things were in Medina, with all the different plots from the hypocrites and from the Jewish tribes, those who were facing the Prophet ﷺ, all kinds of betrayal and plotting and so on. And the Prophet ﷺ and the believers, they were facing this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these verses to the Prophet ﷺ to show him how to deal with all of these difficulties, and to call people to the truth, and to hold fast to the deen, and to reminding the believers of the ways of the people of the book before, so that they don't fall into the same sins that they did, so that they do not bring the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on them. So the verses talked about this, and it talked about how to deal with the enemies, and how to deal with the friend, and with those who are showing signs, which is the hypocrites, how to deal with them clearly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made that matter so much clear in these verses, and giving the comfort to the believers that don't worry too much about how the disbelievers are plotting against you. Definitely protect yourself, but worry more about your own being. Are you obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are you seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone? Otherwise, the disbelievers, nothing would avail them, their wealth or their children. Do not be attached. You do not wish to be like them because they committed the worst crimes whatsoever. And then the lessons learned from the battle of Uhud, which just a beginning of it, which great lessons that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that this was a benefiting thing for the ummah, that such an event to happen, so that they would come out from it very strong, learning the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. And it teaches us also that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, although they are the best generation ever brought to mankind, but they were not sinless people, right? They would learn from their mistakes too. Once the verses of the Quran comes down to correct them, there's no ifs and buts and this and that and their opinions. It's complete submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was pleased with them. And that's for us, if we want to be among those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with, what are we doing with the verses of the Quran? When we read it, when we recite it, does it affect our hearts? We see our situations. Are we still dealing with riba, with usury, with interest after we heard these verses? Or are we going to still seek excuses or maybe this or that? And this is the difference between the Sahaba radiallahu anhum and those who came after them. But we need to save ourselves. We need to have that submission, and never you will regret if you would follow the orders of Allah. You would never regret if you're steadfast on the deen of Allah.
And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us and give us the tawfiq to act upon what we recited today and what we will recite inshallah in the future. Ameen. Sheikh, I want to thank you for coming out and joining us for another wonderful episode. Once again, thank you very much. I want to thank both of you for giving us absolutely amazing recitations. Ayman, we really enjoyed your recitation, and Imad, we always enjoy having you on the show as well. Dear viewers, that brings us to the end of today's theme, which was Best of Nations. I hope you guys enjoyed today's episode, and we hope to see you for many more episodes. And until then, may God bless us all. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
قل لئن اجتمعت الإنس والجن على أن يأتوا بمثل هذا القرآن لا يأتون بمثله وما